thanks, Adam, and thanks, David and his team, for inviting me to this conference. It's the 25th year, I believe, and even though I'm not necessarily a great lover of what I call the unemployment industry, which is Australia's 19th industry, courtesy of very poor government policy, David does a great job, and so does his team. What I want to talk about today is our labour underutilisation crisis and reasons and remedies. So essentially, whether you believe it or not, the media certainly doesn't. They're slowly grasping the nettle. But Australia has what I call a labour market crisis. It's been emerging for 20 to 25 years. It's persistent and it's entrenched. And the amount of labour resources that we're willingly and deliberately wasting is high already. It's rising. It's broadening. And our political class on both sides of politics and what I call the unemployment industry, the people that professionally manage this disaster, are effectively in denial. And my basic hypothesis, I've just finished a book on the Eurozone, which will be published towards the end of the year. It's about the Eurozone groupthink. And what I call this neoliberal groupthink is a organised institutional structure that undermines our policy, our prosperity, and deliberately leads to policies that work against everything that policy should be aiming for, and that is to expand our well-being and provide broadened opportunities for people who are disadvantaged. And that neoliberal groupthink, which I'll talk about more in a moment, has an ideological basis. And it succeeds by framing agendas and abusing economic concepts. And so the majority of people in this room, with all due respect, will have such a perverted view of economics and how the economy operates that you willingly go along and vote for political parties that damage your very own prosperity, even though you mightn't recognise it directly in that way. And what I also argue, I've been doing some work with cognitive linguists and social psychologists, and they're very big on so-called framing. This is work that has been popularised by George Lakoff and his group in America. And the success of the neoliberal agenda, the way it's got us all sucked in, is down to the way they frame the debate and the way they express ideas and use metaphorical language. So we'll cover that a bit. The important point is that when confronted with evidence, what we would normally consider to be a fact, the ideological agenda fails at every point. And so for a researcher and a scholar, it's quite a curious thing to get to the bottom of why we normally will operate on a factual basis, but in something as important as economic policy, we accept distortions and falsehoods as facts and allow the policies to undermine prosperity. What groupthink is, this emerged in the early 70s, this idea in social psychology. It's, as I write it here, and I don't want to read it all out, It's a social dynamic where groups develop a capacity for self-deception and that they build discipline procedures which force consent and conformity to the values and ethics of the group, whatever they might be. And people within the group are actively discouraged from asking specific questions and actively rewarded for asking other questions. The questions that they're discouraged from asking are those that challenge the values and the ethics and the accepted knowledge base, and I use the knowledge in inverted commas. and they are discouraged from asking questions that might undermine those ethics, values and knowledge. And members are disciplined and ultimately expelled if they do raise controversial issues. And groupthink is a very powerful dynamic. And, you know, it works in academic disciplines, for example, in economics. If you're an outsider like me, it's very hard to become a professor. There's very few professors of economics that have the same views that I have. The vast majority of people that have got to the top of the academic hierarchy are locked into the idea that free markets are self-regulating and that government policy is essentially bad. And will distort the market, and if you leave the market, it will deliver the best outcomes. There's very few people that don't believe that in the academic halls of economics. This is groupthink. And if you, you know, I've been at conferences where the discussant to my keynote speech has said, we've been visited by a man from Mars today. And that's the sort of the coercion that groupthink operates with. It's meant to embarrass me, water off a duck's back, but the point is that it embarrasses most people, and most people can't get promotion, they can't get research grants, they can't get published. And this works in both academic hierarchies, in central banks, in government departments, in private corporations. And it's sort of like a mob rule. It's very powerful, and it's very hostile to different ideas. And I'm really grateful that David and his group are welcoming of diversity of viewpoints, even if they might confront the mainstream that his own organisation operates within. And, you know, when I think about the most recent changes to labour market policy in Australia, you know, when a government forces workers to apply for 40 jobs, as a reasonable proposition, when it's quite obvious there are not enough jobs around, that's the operation of groupthink working. It's a denial of reality. It's a reinforcement of the internal discipline of the group. Okay, here's a historical picture. I've got about six or seven, maybe eight, I can't remember, pictures first. And this is from 1861. This is the Australian official national unemployment rate. It's stitched together from a number of different sources. But it's a fairly coherent time series. The red period, and the red's only chosen for highlight, not for anything else, is the period of what I call the full employment period in Australia, where governments took responsibility after the Second World War. The Second World War cleaned up the Great Depression, and that was because governments funded the prosecution of the war effort with massive fiscal interventions, massive government spending, and running big deficits. And that got rid of the unemployment from the Great Depression. All of the remedies that had been tried through the 1930s, the so-called classical remedies, which are really versions of free market remedies now, failed. They made the situation worse. It was only really when we had what we now would refer to as a Keynesian expansion due to the war that we cleaned up unemployment. And the task of the post-war period, of course, the immediate post-war period, was how to maintain that full employment and the obvious prosperity that it was going to bring in a peacetime when you weren't buying tanks and bombing the hell out of your neighbours. And governments took response. There were a number of all the advanced countries brought out what we would call a white paper in the mid-40s. There was a famous white paper in Australia in 1945. And that laid out the charter where governments realised that the capitalist system was dynamically unstable, that if it was left alone, it would lead to entrenched unemployment. And it could get stuck in a dynamic of under full employment spending, and it couldn't get out of that because confidence would be low, people who were unemployed didn't have incomes and couldn't spend. And so it was realised that you needed some intervention when the private economy cycled down to resolve that and maintain full employment and stability. And that intervention was via government policy and government spending and taxation adjustments. And that became the consensus in the post-war period, right around the world. And as you can see, the average unemployment rate up until 1975 was 2.1%. And for those old enough will remember, you know, the Menzies government nearly lost power in the 1961 election because unemployment just went above 2%. And the irony, of course, is he won that election on Communist Party preferences in one of the inner Brisbane electorates, which I thought was rather good. And what happened in the mid-70s, of course, we had a major disruption to the world economy in the form of the OPEC oil price rises, where the OPEC organisation hiked prices. The second of the oil price shocks came with a war where in the Middle East, and this disrupted oil supplies. Oil prices rose very, very significantly. That created inflation, and the response of governments was exactly the wrong one. It was to reduce aggregate spending, try to reduce economic activity because they believed that was the cause of the inflation, whereas in fact the inflation was what we now call a supply-side shock, a cost of raw material shock, and the appropriate response would have been to try to come up to some consensus with unions and employers to allow that shock to work through the wage and price system without creating the unemployment. And that shock, though, corresponded to a major shift in the academy among economists, and this was the abandonment of Keynesian thinking and the resurgence of what we called at the time monetarism. And monetarism really was just a revisiting of the pre-Keynesian period in the 1920s and early 1930s, which had failed dismally in the Great Depression, which had been rejected on theoretical grounds and also practical grounds by the Keynesian revolution, so to speak. And from that period onwards, we've had an increasing dominance of what has morphed out of monetarism, this what we now call neoliberalism, this belief that the self-regulating free market will deliver prosperity, and the role of government is just to guarantee property rights and to get out of the market altogether. And of course, you know, there's been a sequence of deregulations, privatisations, and all the rest of the things that we're now familiar with, which have reinforced that economic approach. And there's also been a vilification of the use of fiscal policy. And so suddenly, in the 1950s, 60s and early 70s, deficits were seen as good. And I'll come back to that. Now they're seen as horrendous, to be avoided at all costs. And the costs have been, of course, that unemployment has skyrocketed again and has averaged 6.9% since then. This is the red line is the labour force in Australia. The period is 1945, if you can't see very well, to current period. Then the blue line is total employment. And from the period of the divergence, where's my pointer? Here. This divergence started here. That was the last Whitlam-Hayden budget. And it was if you go back in history and read the budget papers, you'll see that was the first time in the presentation of the federal government's budget papers where deficits were labelled as being bad. Up until then, you didn't have this discussion about the fetish of deficits and the need for surpluses. This was the first time we started to see that creeping into the dialogue and the narrative. And of course, since that time, we've pursued various forms of what we now call fiscal austerity, the pursuit of budget surpluses, and total employment has never gone close to the labour force growth again. And you can see that the gap between that, this is the 91 downturn, this is the 82 recession, and the gap between that is, of course, unemployment. Now, let's have another look at that. This is, red is the labour force again, and green is private employment. And it's over a shorter period because we can't get public employment and private employment back before that. It's now 1966. And you can see this period here is when private employment fell away, and that was this initial rise in unemployment, this rise here, the big rise that we've never really recovered from. And from about the start of the 2000s, private employment grew more or less just a bit ahead of population growth, but not much more. But the important difference there is that whereas down here, where it was growing in scale to population growth, it was mainly full-time employment. Whereas after this period, where it starts to grow again more strongly than this abysmal period, and this abysmal period, as I said, this is the abysmal period, and this is the slightly stronger growth period in private employment, where the official unemployment rate fell. In this period here, is marked by a rapid rise in the part-time employment ratio, and an increasing proportion of part-time jobs being precarious, being casualised, precarious, and of course, this is a period where real wages growth started to be constrained dramatically in relation to productivity growth, and there was a major redistribution of national income to profits, which started the financial crisis, which is more later. Now, keep that in your mind, and we add one more sector because that's only private employment. Now look at public employment, the blue line. So this abysmal period of private employment growth, you know, in the late 70s under Fraser government and most of the Hawke Keating period in the 80s was offset somewhat. Now remember, private employment's much greater than public employment as a proportion. But it was off, and these are indexes, by the way. So they're indexed at 100 at 1966. So they tell you the relative growth of the three things. So in this period, while private employment was abysmal, public employment was attenuating the rise in unemployment that was occurring. Public employment was working in what we call a counter-cyclical fashion. In other words, the economic cycle goes up, you want the government impulse to be not adding to that. When the private economic cycle is going down towards recession, you want the public economic cycle to be pushing up, countering the downturn in private activity. And that's sort of why we had such low unemployment consistently in that red period I showed you during the full employment era, because government policy should always work counter-cyclically. That's the purpose of policy in one respect. Now, look what happened after the 91 recession. We had the real intensity of the Keating sort of grasp of neoliberalism, and then of course the manic grasp by Costello and Howard, and after that public employment drops significantly. And while private employment was starting to recover a bit but increasingly biased towards casualisation and underemployment, we had public employment basically falling off as a proportion of the population growth. Now, public employment was still rising in absolute terms, but that was just because the scale of the economy was getting bigger and the population was growing. But it fell off in proportion quite dramatically. And so this period, the pursuit of budget surpluses, which became an obsession, was reinforcing the precariousness that was emerging in the private labour markets. And most people, I think, if you ask them, wouldn't know that. The other part of the crisis is the recent plunge of participation rates. So the participation rate is the proportion of people that are in the labour force. They're either... the proportion of the working age population above 15 that are in the labour force, either unemployed or employed. And so what we've seen, the blue line is the total for everybody, and that's fallen quite dramatically since November 2010 as the employment growth becomes virtually zero and people give up looking because they're sick to death of not getting replies to their job applications or not getting success in interviews. And the other part of the crisis, this is teenagers. A massive drop in teenage labour force participation. And that's not going into education. That's going into what we call NEET, not in employment, not in education, not in training. And I'll document what the implications of that are in a second. This is the period since February 2008, another angle of the crisis. February 2008 was the low point unemployment rate of the last cycle, so to speak. It was when the unemployment rate reached 4%, it was at the lowest point. And this is the changes in employment since then, up until last month's labour force data. And the green line is the total workforce, and the blue is the teenagers. So the relevant things are, since February 2008, teenagers have lost 107,000 jobs altogether, of which 97,700 have been full-time. And so even though there's been 929,000 jobs created all told, which, by the way, might sound big, but that's abysmal in itself relative to the scale of the situation and the time period that we're considering, more than 6 years, teenagers have gone backwards. So any growth that the Australian economy have had has excluded our teenagers. And as I make the point in this graph here, that you often hear discussions about the ageing society, and that's used as one of these myths to justify running surpluses, that we need to save up for that. Well, the real challenge of the ageing society and the rising dependency ratios is that if all of us older people want to have the same standard of living we have now, we need to make sure that the smaller proportion of workers that are going to be supporting us are more productive than we are. The main challenge of ageing population is productivity challenge. And that tells me that we need strong education, strong investment in public infrastructure, strong engagement with our future workforce, which is our teenagers, for God's sake. And by excluding them from the workforce and excluding them from employment growth and the ability to gain experience, that is a crisis that's going to span decades and ultimately undermine the future prosperity of all of us. This is just another angle, the teenage employment population ratio, dramatic fall. This is long-term unemployed for teenagers. It's now rising. How the hell can a sophisticated, advanced Western country allow a teenager who wants to work to be unemployed for more than 52 weeks? How does that work? What groupthink is operating to allow all of us to sit here in this room and allow that to happen? How does a majority of people vote for a government that will allow that to happen and won't instantly declare it an emergency? And what we've now got, we've had this crisis going for 6 years now since the downturn started again, and we've now got teenagers who have become adults who will never have worked. Not that they don't want to. The research shows that, you know, 95-97% of people who are unemployed openly want to work next day if there was a job offered. So forget the Dole Bludger, Skiver, Lena, whatever the nomenclature is used. Forget all that. That's groupthink. The other angle of the crisis, of course, is that, and I mentioned it in the quality of our employment, underemployment's rising. So underemployment is part-time workers who declare they want more hours. And on average, the underemployed want to work about 15 more hours. So closer to full-time than a little bit. And remember, to be counted as employed, you only have to work 1 hour a week or more. And the trend since the 1990s has been, and you can see that this was the 91 recession where underemployment rose dramatically and has never really come back down again and ratchets up every time the economy slows. The the bias is now towards 1 hour a week rather than full-time in job creation. And so when you hear a treasurer of any political persuasion get up there when the labour force data comes out and boasts about how many jobs have been created under his or her watch, we're waiting for a female treasurer, I just sit there and say bunkum. I'd probably say worse than that. Because the quality of work and the number of hours that people want to work and can't get is an important dimension of employment creation. Okay, so putting all that together, these are some calculations I did the other day. This is teenagers, this is all workers, and these are characteristics of our labour market crisis. So the unemployment rate, teenagers now officially, this is the ABS measure, about 20.4%, for all of us 6.4%. That's a disaster just in itself. Then if we consider those participation rate effects that I mentioned before, you get so these are what we call hidden unemployed or discouraged workers. If we add them back into the unemployed, there's about 92,000 of them who are teenagers and about 185,000 who are all of us. If you add them back in, the adjusted unemployment rate, so hidden unemployed would work tomorrow if they're offered a job they've just given up looking. So they fail the activity test of the ABS. So if you add them back in, the teenage rate goes up to 28.6% and the overall rate goes up to 7.8%. If you then consider the underemployment rate, which is a lack of hours of work, which is in a way like unemployment, even though you've got some work, you want more, you're not being utilised to the extent that you desire, then, and it's obviously a manifestation of a job shortage, then these are the unofficial, these are ABS statistics, these 16.7.6. If you add them to that, you get a broad labour underutilisation rate for teenagers of 45.3%. And for the rest of, for the overall, 15.4%. Now this is our future workforce. And this is everybody. So, and this was, you know, when the previous treasurer was raving on about how close we are to full employment and how we needed to get back into surplus to avoid inflation pressures coming from full employment, this was about 13%, something like that. And now with the current austerity that the federal government's trying to impose on us, it's risen again as the private sector slows down. That data is a crisis, and it represents a systematic failure of the economy to create enough work. And the culprit in that is the federal government. This is by way of education, and I'm trying to break down the groupthink in the room, you see, because we're all sucked into it without any disrespect being shown. We're all sucked in by framing. It's very effective and very subtle. And I just want to focus on the blue bars here. This is the history since 1953 of federal government fiscal balances, the difference between tax and government spending. So if it's below the line, it's a deficit. If it's above the line, it's a surplus. And you can see that overwhelmingly, the federal government has run continuous fiscal deficits. And the important point is that during this period, up to about here, GDP growth was 4.5% per annum, and after that it's been 3.1%. So when you hear the central bank governor talk about getting back onto trend growth, well, trend growth is much lower than it used to be, and it's inadequate to maintain full employment anyway. So it's not even a desirable objective. It's a growth rate that's suppressed by fiscal austerity, by the neoliberal obsession with fiscal surpluses. This was the Keating surpluses here, which ended in a major recession. That green drop, that's GDP growth rate, by the way, the green line. The history of all advanced countries is when a government tries to run fiscal surpluses, typically what follows very soon after is a major recession. 91 recession. Then we had the Costello period. Now, how was Costello able to run all those surpluses and growth not fall below zero? Well, the answer lies in the fact that under Hawke and Keating, this period here, the wages policy deliberately suppressed real wages growth. Real wages were cut during that period, and the trade unions went along with it to their internal disgrace, in my view. And productivity kept growing, and for those who know what the gap is, that's a redistribution of national income towards profits away from wages. There was a massive, the wage share in national income was, in the early 80s, was around 60%. It's now about 51, 52%. So where did all that real income go that was redistributed to profits? Well, it found its way into executive salaries, and it also, the major part of it, went into the financial markets and speculation. And of course, the capitalist system had a bit of a problem because real wages are typically grown in proportion with productivity. And that made sense because productivity is adding more into the marketplace per worker that has to be bought. And real wages growth is the capacity of us to buy increasing amounts. And so if there's a gap between real wages and productivity, the realisation system has a problem. Who's going to buy all this stuff? Well, the capitalists found a fantastic solution to that, a double whammy type solution. They started to lend us all that redistributed money. And this was the rise of the financial planners and credit cards turning up in our mail in the sort of early 90s with $10,000 credit limits in it, just unsolicited. Children getting $10,000 credit cards. And the household sector bought that like crazy. It was like, you know, Marx used to talk about religion being the opiate of the masses, is suppressing them from revolution. Well, consumption and credit is the modern way in which the group think is reinforced. And we borrowed like crazy, and household debt to disposable income went from something like 75-80% in the 80s, it's now around 180-170%. Massive build-up in household exposure to debt and precariousness in our individual balance sheets. And because we were willing to maintain the consumption, not through real wages growth, which is the traditional way, but through debt growth, we were able to maintain growth in the economy, and Costello was able to get away with the surpluses coming through the tax revenue. If we hadn't have bought the financial planning myths and the whole credit binge idea, then his pursuit of surpluses would have lasted 1 or 2 years, 3 years maximum, we would have been back in recession. And what we've got now is a... I don't know what the next slide is. What we've got now is a situation where we're resorting back to typical behaviour. That's the private sector. Household, in that Costello surplus period, savings ratio out of disposable income went negative for the first time. It was crazy. We were, as a total household sector, dis-saving, whereas previously we'd averaged between 10 and 16% of our disposable income. We're back to that now. We're back to about 10%, creeping back up. In other words, we've decided that we're not going to have any more credit binges. It's too dangerous. It's too precarious. We're saving again and trying to de-lever, is the expression. We're trying to reduce our exposure to debt. And, of course, investment isn't going to go back to the crazy levels that were associated with the mining boom and also the consumption boom, because there's plenty of capacity, productive capacity in the economy now as consumption growth slows down. So what does that tell you about the conduct of government involvement in the economy via fiscal policy? It has to go back to normal. which is continuous deficits. The Costello period, this period here, is totally atypical in our history. And so, you know, even though the groupthink has... Groupthink, by the way, denies history or reinvents it. And so for most of us, we're led to believe that fiscal surpluses are the norm. Well, no, they're not. Fiscal deficits are the norm in every advanced country. Continuous deficits of around 1.5%, 2% of GDP are the norm. And that makes sense because the non-government sector wants to save a bit and take some money out of the spending stream each year to save up. And so it has to come in from the government sector if the non-government sector is taking it out. And that's the way we maintain full employment in the full employment era after the war. Okay, what are we doing here? Okay, we'll just move on. Here are two visions of the economy. This is the neoliberal vision that we're sold every day. And this has us here as supplicants, and the natural environment are supplicants to this deity called the economy. The economy is everything, and we're its servants. And if we just leave that alone and let it rip, then through self-regulation, it will deliver, and competition, it will deliver the best for all of us, as long as we just obey that. And the other part of this vision is that that economy can get ill. We're told that it can get sick, it needs fixing. And it gets typically sick if the government intervenes and tries to regulate it and tries to discipline entrepreneurial spirit, as it's called. And the solution to getting it well again is to repair the budget. You've heard that over and over in the last few months. We've got to repair the budget. Well, the budget's not a patient, for God's sake. The economy's not a patient. And we're told that it's a sort of moralising narrative that we've got to sacrifice for this economy. And if you live in Europe, well, I've done a lot of research in Europe lately, that, you know, everybody's told they've got to sacrifice to get the European economy well again. And that if we do sacrifice, then we'll be rewarded for that. And anybody who doesn't show that necessary discipline and sacrifice are classified as miscreants. So the poor haven't worked hard enough, made bad choices. The unemployed, obviously, just wanting to live on income support. Who would want to live on below the poverty line income support, for God's sake? And see their social network shrink to about one. See their marriage break up. See their kids unable to get any proper going outings at school. Who would want to live on that? But that's what we're told. And, of course, the problem with this narrative, which is framed in a very skillful way by think tanks, by the media, by politicians, by supporting industry groups, by peak bodies of employers. The problem is that progressives have bought it. And so you get progressive narratives coming out, oh, look, you know, we know that there's a budget emergency, but we'll just do it, we'll just fix it up in a more fair way. So the debate about the current budget is about fairness. It's not about the fiscal deficit, in my view, should be twice as big as it is at the moment, given that labour market crisis. The government should be spending much more than it is in net terms. Yet the progressive side of politics and their narrative is, well, it's just unfair. Well, that's buying into the groupthink and reinforcing it, that both sides of politics become entrapped in the same narrative. Here's an alternative vision. This is what I would call the true progressive vision, that is evidence-based and recognises reality, that we're embedded in the natural system. The natural system nurtures us. It's not something we can trade off for economic growth, It's not something that we can buy or sell. It's a biological system. And we're embedded in that. And we've constructed this thing called an economy, that it's not a natural thing, it's us. We created it. And the only reason we created it, an organised system of work, was so that it would work for us. The economy is us. We control it. It's our creation. It's not something beyond us as a deity that we have to bend down to and sacrifice for. And the government, by and large, we like to do things on our own, within our families or whoever we're hanging out with. But we also are smart enough to know that there are some things that we can't do as individuals and that we have to do as collectives. And to organise that, we formed governments. And governments are our agents. They're not our religious confessor. They're our agents. And we want them. They're not some moral arbiter punishing us if we're not sacrificing hard enough or pulling our belts in or wanting too much. They're our agents, for God's sake, and they're there to make sure that that thing that we've created works to fulfil our objectives. And so it comes down to what are our objectives? Are our objectives to have 45% of our teenagers underemployed in one way or unemployed, not working in one way or another? That would be a perverse objective for a society. How the hell do we justify having 15.5% of our whole willing workforce not working in one way or another? How can that, given that we know that we like income and when people work, they produce income for all of us? Yeah. Okay, so 5, did you say? Yeah, okay. So just to finish that little section off, the way in which how we've got to that is because we've accepted a narrative that's built on a metaphorical type language that cognitive psychologists will tell you is the way we think and accept reality and interpret reality. So just very briefly, all of these metaphors, living beyond the means, maxed out the credit card, spending like a drunken sailor, budget black holes, mushrooming, all the language, run out of money, it's broke. How can the Australian government ever run out of money? It issues the currency. I can run out of money if I go and blow out too much in the shops, but the Australian government can never be run out of money. Hockey said the other day, we're running out of money. That is an outright lie. Yet people believe it. We've got to run a surplus because we've got to save up. How can the government save? It issues the currency. What most people don't understand is in 1971, a major shift occurred in the international monetary system when the fixed exchange rate system broke down and we entered the era of fiat currencies. Now, fiat currencies have no value. Prior to that, they were backed by gold. I'm being simplistic now for lack of time, but they were backed by gold. After that, they were of no value. And the only reason we try to get hold of that intrinsically, the government's currency, because we know we've got to pay taxes in that currency. And the implications of that are that the government has no financial constraint. It can never run out of money. Any constraints it puts on itself, like deficit ratios or debt ratios, are purely voluntary and they're ideologically based to fulfil an agenda to limit the capacity of governments to do good for us. And mass unemployment is the result of the budget deficit being too low. That we're trying, the non-government sector is trying to save, and the government has to fund that saving by filling that spending gap. Because firms don't employ unless there's sales, and sales require us to spend. Spending creates income, which creates output, which creates employment. So if the non-government sector wants to save some of the income that's produced each period and not pump that back into spending, then someone has to pump that difference into spending, and that's what the government sector has to do. Okay, just the last point I want to make is, first of all, if this is a fair, a more reasonable interpretation of what we have before us, we've got to break down views that think we have to obey this. We have to make this work for us. And so there's a range of objectives that we might want to define as being how we evaluate government policy. We shouldn't ever evaluate government policy by what the fiscal deficit is. The fiscal deficit is just a vehicle to achieve objectives. And so we should be saying, is a fiscal deficit of 2% adequate to achieve our deficit? It might be 10%. It might be a surplus, depending upon what the non-government sector is doing. So these are all desirable goals, in my view. And the last 2 minutes, I'll talk about a minimum policy intervention, which I call the job guarantee. My research centre and Jobs Australia were partners in a big Australian Research Council grant some years ago, where we teased out a complete plan to introduce this a job guarantee. What's the problem? The problem is a lack of jobs. The private sector has never provided enough jobs to fully employ the workforce. It never has, it never will. And so we can't get a solution to that problem by supply-side measures. What do I mean by that? By attacking the unemployed, by attacking the victims of the job shortage. I think the current labour market policy borders on psychological torture. And it's sort of akin to the locking up children on Manus Island. The unemployed can't search for jobs that are not there. So the minimum condition for a sophisticated society, in my view, is to introduce a employment guarantee. Close down Centrelink, defund the unemployment industry, sorry, and announce that from now on, the government will provide a minimum wage job, minimum wage being a socially acceptable minimum wage that allows you to live in society without social exclusion. A minimum wage job to anybody who can't find a job. Turn up to the Centrelink office, which now has Job Guarantee headquarters on the nameplate rather than Centrelink, and you'll get a job at a minimum wage. Maintain a buffer stock of jobs, and if the private sector thinks that that there's too many workers in the Job Guarantee, then they can do something about it, and we all know what that is. They can increase the rate of investment, increase their own productive spending, and employ them themselves. And the job guarantee pool would oscillate up and down according to private sector spending. It would be low in some periods and quite high at the moment. And that's the minimum. It doesn't mean the government shouldn't be investing in public infrastructure, education, research, all the rest of the things that are going to underpin our future. But it solves the unemployment problem immediately, and all you people could then go off and do more creative things with your time. I'll leave it at that.